I'm here to introduce you to another speaker. Bastian, welcome.
Hello. Nice to be here.
It's good to see you again.
Likewise.
Even though we're not here, you know, in person, but well.
That would be even better, but yeah, better than nothing.
Exactly.
And of course, Italy would be a lot nicer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Of course. Of course. Welcome. You will be speaking about deploying Symfony applications to. Okay. This will be the first question then. Is it Kubernetes or is it Kubernetes or is it Kubernetes or what is it?
I would say Kubernetes.
Kubernetes. Okay. Yeah. So you're talking about deploying Symfony application to Kubernetes.
Yes.
You work at Rancher. Now I'm a happy user of Rancher. We use it in production, so we're very, very happy with it. What do you do at Rancher?
First of all, great. I didn't even know that. So it's always good to hear good feedback on that. I'm a field engineer. That means I'm helping our customers or future customers to implement Rancher and Kubernetes and containers successfully in a pre-sales process from the technical side, of course.
All right. So you come in, you help people and convince them that this is a good solution, and then they can...
Yeah, most of the time they're actually already convinced, and it's more like, okay, how do I set it up correctly? How do I make it scalable? What is the best way to use it? How do I actually, can I integrate it into my environment?
Excellent. Today, will we see anything? Will we see anything about Rancher, or will it purely be focused on Kubernetes?
It will mostly be focused on Kubernetes, but we will also see a bit of Rancher just because it makes it a lot easier to set up and. Use, and I can explain it better within 45 minutes.
Okay, great. Bastian, good luck.
Thank you. Okay, awesome. You can see my slides. We already talked about the title. It is about how can you, when you get started, deploy your first Symfony application or any application in the end to a Kubernetes cluster. Let's dive right into this. I have a couple of slides, and then there's going to be a lot of live demos to show you how easy or how hard it can be. I guess most of you are kind of aware, at least, what Kubernetes is. It is a container orchestration platform. That means it helps you to deploy, run, and scale your applications that are packaged in containers somewhere on your servers. So it's a bit of like a nice container orchestration abstraction layer. What is so great about this? Software usually is not just running in your data center, and not every data center is looking the same. So you can, for example, start running software in your data center on premise, maybe even in your cellar somewhere on some servers. You can choose a cloud provider to run your applications. But at some point, probably also your applications are going to run on a developer machine or maybe also on some or any kind of edge devices. So an edge device could be, for example, some servers that you have in a store, like a supermarket, or that could be a 5G cellular tower. It could be a windmill in a wind park. It could be a cruise ship. It could be a train, aircraft, charging station for electric cars, basically everything where you run software that is somehow connected and that you somehow want to update also and monitor and manage. You need some way to get your software on that. And one of the really great properties of Kubernetes is that it can run on all these different environments, on all these different infrastructures, and then abstract the differences of all these infrastructures away. So that from a usage point of view, it looks the same and works the same and behaves the same. So if you use Kubernetes as a way to orchestrate and deploy and manage your containers, Kubernetes provides a common compute platform across all these different environments. And then not only helps you with providing an API that you can use to deploy your packaged applications, your containers somewhere, but it also helps you with setting up networking, storage, load balancing, service discovery, providing access control, security policies, auto-scaling, backups, and everything you basically need for making or running an application successfully and in a scalable and stable way. And by providing a common API across all these different infrastructures, and also by just being used a lot, because basically every cloud provider is providing Kubernetes as a managed solution. Hosting providers are providing that, and it gets easier and easier to install it with lots of different distributions. A lot of tools and platforms integrate with Kubernetes. And that's kind of like just like, I don't know, a graph of lots of icons of toolings that can directly and natively talk with the Kubernetes API, integrate with it, and that you can then seamlessly use without having to configure lots of manual things. Everything from databases, CI/CD solutions, security scanning tools, container runtimes, service meshes, and so on. But that's also, on the other hand, it's great that all these tools are integrating into it, but it can make it kind of hard and complicated to choose, okay, which tools am I going to use? And then you may also have heard at some point that, yeah, Kubernetes is nice, but it's really hard and complicated to set up. It's really hard and complicated to upgrade, to manage, and also to use even. And in the next, when we have 40 minutes, I want to show you that it's not anymore the case. It got a lot easier and you can quickly benefit from it. And one part or one solution that makes Kubernetes easier, and I would say even boring, is what Scoop and I had been talking about before. For example, the Rancher Kubernetes Management Server. Just to give you, because we are going to see this in the UI a couple times, to just deploy something in Kubernetes and to explain to you what it does and what it is. First of all, it's 100% open source. So it's you can use it free. You can start using it, tomorrow. And Rancher is a central management platform that allows you to provision, manage, upgrade Kubernetes clusters on multiple environments, cloud providers, data centers, edge devices. And on top of that, also gives you a UI that you can use to manage your applications and your containers in it, and direct integrations with common tooling that you need in order to make your applications run in a stable, production-ready way. Things like monitoring, log shipping, security policies, authentication, and so on. So with that, Kubernetes is not that hard and complicated anymore. There is still a learning curve because you have to learn a new technology. You have to learn a bit about the Kubernetes API, but it's not anymore the case that it's something that takes weeks or years or months to learn and set up. So for the remainder of the talk, I'll give you a short introduction into how Kubernetes actually works and what are the API concepts that you have to know and use to deploy your containers into a Kubernetes cluster. And then we're gonna set up in a live demo Kubernetes the easy way, install Rancher so that we have a nice UI and don't have to look at the YAML all the time. And then we deploy our first Symfony application to it and look a bit into what you can use for monitoring and debugging this application. Okay, so most of the stuff will be demos. But first, let's get everyone on the same page to explain a bit, okay, what is Kubernetes and how does it work and what are the API concepts, the primitives of Kubernetes. On the lowest level, you have a container image. And I started talking about containers directly, but just to get everyone on the same page, let's shortly revisit what a container actually is. Containers are started from container images. And a container image contains your whole application code as well as all application dependencies. That is then, for example, in a Symfony application, it would be a web server, an Nginx or an Apache, the PHP runtime. It would be all extensions that you need. It would be all the libraries these extensions need. It probably would be something like curl. In the end, the complete user land of a Linux is all put together into a container image. So basically, you can think about a container image as the file system that you usually would have on a server. And in the end, the image itself is a tar file. You can, and that contains your application code and the whole file system. And then if you want to start this container image inside of a container somewhere, you basically take this image, start it somewhere, which means you have a container runtime that takes this tar file, extracts it, and then starts a process inside of this file system on the server in a way that this process only sees itself. It doesn't see any other processes running on the system. It also starts it in a way that you can limit how much CPU and memory the process inside of this container is run using. And it starts it in a way that it only sees its own file system and nothing around this. And it can configure the network in a way that different applications in different containers can communicate with each other over the network, and also creates some encapsulation for that. Important there to understand is that if you run a container, it is not virtualization. So the process inside of the container is still running natively on the system without any overhead. And containers are great, because what this means is you put your whole application with all of its dependencies into an image. You can test this image anywhere, and you can put this image on any kind of server and start it. And then you have a tested application with exactly the PHP version, with exactly the extensions that you tested. And if you want to upgrade something, you just build a new image, you can test it, and then put it on your servers. So deployment is going to be a lot easier with that. And containers are great. You can take them, and if you manage a couple of them, start them up manually on some servers, awesome. It gets complicated when your system grows larger and you not only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or a couple of containers, but multiple of them. And then the problem is, okay, you have hundreds of containers you want to start somewhere, probably on dozens of servers with multiple applications that should communicate with each other. How do you ensure that you are using your computation power, your CPU and memory as efficiently as possible? How can you automate putting containers on all these servers? How you can decide which container should be on which server? How you can you ensure that the networking works correctly? How you can you ensure policies and security? And of course, it's something that you can build on your own, or you can use something as a solution for that everyone else is using already, which is Kubernetes as a container orchestration platform. So what it helps you with is basically putting your containers on your servers without you having to decide manually what to put where, and then do a lot of stuff around it. And it does this by providing an API. And at this Kubernetes API, you can declare with a declarative syntax, and you can describe what the desired state of all the resources inside of a Kubernetes cluster should be. For example, if you want to start a new container, you say, hey, this is a container. I want to start it somewhere in the Kubernetes cluster. You post this at the API, and then the Kubernetes cluster will try to fulfill your wishes and get the cluster and all your servers in the state as you desired. Of course, if you use such an API as Kubernetes, you need to know a bit about the API objects. How can you start containers? And let's walk through these different resources in the Kubernetes API in a few minutes. On the lowest level and the smallest object that you interact with, the smallest unit of deploying containers in Kubernetes is called a pod. A pod is actually a collection, a list of one or more containers that share or can share, that share the same networking, that can share the same storage through shared volumes, and all these containers of one pod are ensured by Kubernetes to be scheduled on the same server, on the same worker node. A pod can be one container, but also multiple ones. And a use case for having packing multiple containers within one pod would be that you, for example, have a pod that contains one container with an Nginx and one container with a PHP FPM process. You have separate container, you can update them separately, build them separately, but then you put them together as one pod. They can communicate network-wise over localhost with each other, so very fast. They can share storage if they want to, but still they are independent containers, but kind of are scheduled together. So if you think about the pod as corresponding to that in a more traditional virtualization or VM-based hosting, a pod could be like a single VM. And you have your 2-3 processes of one application in it that you need. And then you can say, hey, Kubernetes, start this pod somewhere. And you could say, okay, now I want to update a container image within this pod. So I stop this pod and start a new pod with a new image version. To automate this a bit more, Kubernetes also has the concept of a deployment. A deployment is an abstraction in Kubernetes that you can use to manage a number of identical pods. So you can define a deployment and say, I want to have this pod definition in there. For example, a pod with my PHP FPM in my Nginx container. And I want to run this 3 times in my cluster. Then Kubernetes, because of this deployment definition, will start 3 pods looking like this in your cluster. And when you update this deployment, it will also provide you with a 0 downtime rolling upgrade from version 1 of your container images to version 2 of your container images. So let's have a look a bit how this works. You have here, we have here a deployment resource in a declarative syntax, and this is basically the API payload that you would post as a user against the Kubernetes API. And usually these payloads are written in YAML. You can also write them in JSON, but usually it's YAML. And here you say, I want to create a deployment called Nginx. I want to run it 3 times in my cluster, and each pod within these deployments should have, in this case, one container, an Nginx container. You post this against the API, and then Kubernetes will ensure that within the Kubernetes cluster, 3 pods, each within one Nginx container, will run. And yeah, if you then update it, or if you update it, Kubernetes will then stop one container and maybe start a new one with a new version and so on, and does this in a way that your application is continuing to run, is continuing to be reachable, and slowly your application is going to be updated. Each pod inside of a Kubernetes cluster also has its own IP address. So what you then probably need, if you have your Nginx here running 3 times and each of these 3 pods has its own IP address, you probably need some kind of load balancer before that, in front of that, to have a single IP address that load balances over all of your instances. And this also is a thing that exists in Kubernetes and is called a service. You can think of a service as an internal load balancer that exposes one IP address and one internal DNS record in front of multiple pods and then load balances in between them, and also benefits of things like health checking. So in this case, if you have a client here that should, you have here your deployment, your pod with 3 IP addresses, and then you have a service in front of this. This has its own IP address, its own DNS record. So a client, be it another application running inside of the Kubernetes cluster or a user, can just use this one endpoint to then load balance to all the pods. And also if something changes here and a pod for some reason is stopped and then maybe started somewhere else from this application and gets a new IP address, the service here, the internal load balancer, will be reconfigured automatically. The last thing we need for starting with it and deploying on our first application then is not only this load balancer here that does the distribution of traffic to the pods, but then for actually exposing our application to end users, there's another concept called an ingress. And an ingress, you can think of like a layer 7 HTTP load balancer. So where a service basically just does TCP load balancing and distributes TCP connections and TCP packages from the client to all the pods running behind the service, an ingress controller is aware of your HTTP requests. And with that, usually what you have is one ingress controller running, for example, an Nginx running inside of the Kubernetes cluster that takes all the incoming traffic from outside, from the internet, and based on the host name that comes in of that, distributes it then internally to the correct internal Kubernetes services and pods. And then also does things like TLS termination, sticky session handling, and all the features you usually have in a load balancer that you put in front of everything. So you can think of it kind of like a name-based virtual hosting that you have as it. If you can't follow me on that, it will make sense in a couple of minutes when we have a look at this in the demo. So in this case, you have in a Kubernetes cluster two applications running, two services, and a couple pods behind this, and then two services, service A and service B. And you could say and configure when incoming traffic from the outside into the cluster comes with foo.bar.com/foo, it should be routed to service A, and it comes with, if it comes into the cluster with the host name foo.bar.com/bar, it should be routed to another service. And yeah, the way you can configure this is by saying, hey, I have this ingress resource, this ingress configuration here, this YAML I'm going to add to my Kubernetes API. And here you basically say incoming traffic with this host name and this path goes to service A inside of the Kubernetes cluster, and incoming traffic with this host name and this path goes to service B within the cluster. And you can configure as many of these rules and different host names and different paths as you want. Okay, so what we have seen, there are pods, which is basically one instance of your application. There are deployments that help you orchestrating and your pods and telling Kubernetes, okay, how often do you want to have it running, and help you also with updating this in a zero downtime way. There are services. These are the internal load balancers that you can put in front of all your pods. And then there are ingresses that you then can put at the edge of your cluster to have route incoming traffic from the outside, from the internet correctly. These are kind of the most basic things, the basic primitives and the basic API objects inside of the Kubernetes cluster. There is a lot more. So we haven't talked about security policies, role-based access control, persistent volumes, pod autoscalers, and a lot of other things yet that are also all possible to describe declaratively with the Kubernetes API. You could probably do like a two-day session about expanding all of that. But to get started with just deploying a couple containers, that's what we need. So yeah, let's have a look at this. And let's have a look at the demo. Before I start with actually showing this to you live, maybe a short diagram, what I set up as infrastructure and how our setup is going to look like in the end. So as infrastructure beforehand, I set up three VMs, node 1, node 2, node 3. They are at the moment completely empty. I also set up one load balancer in front of these four VMs. In this case, it would be an AWS network load balancer that just load balances port 80 and port 443 for incoming traffic to these three VMs. And then I created one wildcard DNS entry to point at the load balancer. So that's what I set up before. And then all the other stuff here, for example, creating a Kubernetes cluster, deploying then our Symfony application in here, so that incoming traffic that goes to the nodes will be actually then routed through this internal Kubernetes service to our actual Symfony pods we'll set up now. Okay, so we have three VMs, so we can also quickly look at one. If we just, that I prepared before, so if we just SSH into this one here, we can have a look. It's an Ubuntu 20 VM, and there is nothing running on it but systemd and an SSH daemon. If we want to get started now with setting up a Kubernetes cluster, we need to set this up, and we need kind of a tool to help us with set this up. And what I'm going to use now to set a Kubernetes cluster up within seconds is a Kubernetes distribution called K3S. K3S is a very lightweight Kubernetes distribution where the whole Kubernetes cluster, all the components of a Kubernetes cluster and a Kubernetes control plane are packaged within one binary. And yeah, the most shortest way to install it is to SSH into the server and basically run this command to install a complete single node Kubernetes cluster. I prepared three VMs, so we are using three VMs and want to have a highly available Kubernetes cluster. So in order to do this, I'm using a small helper tool called K3S up. This will SSH into our first server here with the Ubuntu user. It will create a new cluster with the latest K3S version. And I have to set one additional thing. I have to also configure the external IP address of this node here, because on AWS, the external IP address is a floating IP that is not attached to any network interface. So from within the node, you can't see the IP address. I could even remove this, yeah, but doesn't matter so much. And what this command will do, it SSHs into this IP address with the user Ubuntu, and on there, it now downloads the K3S binary that sets up then a Kubernetes cluster. It puts this K3S binary into user local bin K3S. For convenience, it creates a couple of symlinks for other tools that are also bundled in the K3S binary. It creates a script to uninstall and stop everything, and it sets up a systemd service. And that's it. Now we, let's maybe, what this command also created here in our folder is a kubeconfig configuration file. And this file contains the information, okay, under which hostname is the Kubernetes API available, with which CA can I authenticate there with TLS, and with which client certificates can I authenticate against this API. So this is basically the description that I can use now with command line tools or a CI/CD pipeline or any other tool that understands Kubernetes to connect to this cluster and do something with it. So one thing I can do, I can export this file as an environment variable. And now I can use things like kubectl as a Kubernetes command line tool to have a look at the cluster and list, for example, all the nodes inside of the cluster. And currently we have one. And that took like, what, 20, 30 seconds? So I said we want to have a multi-node Kubernetes cluster. So let's maybe do the same K3S up command like before, but with a different IP address here. And let's additionally say I don't want to create a complete new cluster, but join this node, this new server here, to this existing cluster. And if we execute this, K3S up will SSH into this server here, download the K3S binary again, put it under user local bin K3S, create a couple symlinks, create a systemd service, start K3S, and configure it in a way to directly join our server that we created before, so that we have now a two-node cluster afterwards. And to have it completely highly available, let's make a three-node cluster out of that. So same command again, just with a different IP address. And in a couple seconds more, we have a highly available three-node Kubernetes cluster. And yeah, K3S is a Kubernetes distribution, but maybe also important to note, with all these different Kubernetes distributions out there, be it something that you can click together at a cloud provider, things like K3S or other tools that provide you with Kubernetes clusters, the cluster itself and how you interact with the API is completely standardized. So from a usage point of view, all these Kubernetes clusters basically look the same, and it doesn't matter if you use K3S or an EKS cluster at AWS. What's going to come next is going to be the same on any Kubernetes cluster. So now we have here a three-node cluster. It's up and running and working. And for example, with kubectl get pods in all namespaces, you can list and have a look at all the system things that are already included and started up. And we could now use the Kubernetes API to create new pods and create new containers, create new deployments in there, all with YAML. That's definitely possible, but maybe to get started with, it is kind of cumbersome. So one way to make starting and managing this Kubernetes cluster or multiple Kubernetes cluster easier is by using something like a nice UI. And the UI I'm using, because I'm the most familiar with, is the Rancher Management interface and UI. And it's also very quick to install. Rancher itself also just runs as a pod, as a container inside of a Kubernetes cluster. And so what we can do then to install Rancher is, or what we need to do to install Rancher is, we have to start creating pods. And since it would be cumbersome for every user of Rancher or even other third-party tools to do this manually, Kubernetes also has a package manager called Helm. Helm is a bit something like on Ubuntu, it would be apt, or a bit like Composer, that you can use to install and configure pre-packaged applications inside of any Kubernetes cluster. So instead of writing a lot of deployment YAML, I can just say, Helm, install me an application called, in this case, Cert Manager, inside of the Kubernetes namespace Cert Manager, configure it a bit, install it in the version 1.0.4, and this installs me now an application called Cert Manager inside of my cluster. Cert Manager is a tool that can automatically create and renew certificates either from an own CA or self-signed certificates, or also from Let's Encrypt, and automate this process for me so that I don't have to do this all manually. It's also just an application that runs inside of Kubernetes, and it's a helper application that I use so that I get a TLS certificate for the Rancher Management UI. So if we have a look again at all the pods into our cluster, we can see now, and let's make this maybe a bit bigger that it doesn't break in the lines. We can see now there are a couple more containers running here that can help me create certificates. And then I can use this to install Rancher. So I can say, Helm, please install me Rancher inside of the kettle system namespace in the version 2.5.2. Please set the host name of Rancher to this one. And this would be my wildcard DNS entry that points to the load balancer here that sits in front of my three nodes. And yeah, let's just install this. Okay. The installation is done, and you can see now here are the three Rancher pods starting up, being created. We also now have an ingress here being created for this host name, so that incoming traffic on the, with this host name inside of our Kubernetes cluster is then routed to these Rancher pods. And this will probably take another 10, 20 seconds until all the images are loaded, until all these pods are running. And you can see they're running now, but the health checks are not working yet because 0 from 1 containers within this Rancher pods are ready. And yeah, now they start to appear. And in a couple of seconds, we should also see that now the ingress resource is available. And if we now go to the, first of all, we can check if we do kubectl describe ingress in the kettle system namespace, we can see, okay, there is this ingress configuration for Rancher that routes traffic coming in at this host name to these internal IP addresses inside of the cluster. And these internal IP addresses are the IP addresses of my Rancher pods that were configured automatically like this. Okay, if we go now, oh, wanted to go to this one here, to this host name. Let's make this a bit bigger. We get a certificate warning because we are using not Let's Encrypt, but a self-signed certificate. That's fine. But that's fine for now. Typing my password. And you can see now, let's make this a bit bigger. We have the Rancher Management API up and running. Initially, we can provide a password, agree to the terms of services, continue, say, yeah, host name is fine. And we have now a management UI that we can use, first of all, to maybe set up authentication with an Active Directory or LDAP. We can use this to create new Kubernetes cluster on other cloud providers or on other infrastructure. And we can also use this Rancher Management UI to have a look at the cluster where Rancher is running inside. So if you click on here, we can see, okay, we can have a bit of state, how much our cluster is used. We see our three nodes here. We can give additional members permissions to use this cluster. And if we go into the Cluster Explorer, we also have a nice UI that shows us all the different objects from the Kubernetes API that are in there and that I can then also create and manage through this interface. So we can see, for example, here deployments, we have cron jobs, we have pods, autoscalers, ingresses, services, persistent volumes, config maps, that's an internal key value store, a lot of other things. At the moment, it only shows us a thing called user namespaces. If we remove this filter, we can actually see, there are a couple pods running inside of it. For example, we can see our cert manager here. We can see, where is it? The Rancher pods running inside of here. So yeah, we see everything we just installed, but we can also use this UI to maybe create new deployments and deploy a new application. And to prepare this, I created a small Symfony Hello World demo here. And this is just a demo application with a small demo block. And I also, in preparation, built this as a container image and pushed this already to Docker Hub. So let's start with deploying this application, actually. So here, under deployments, we can say, hey, let's create a new deployment. we are gonna give this a name, create this in the default namespace, maybe say we want to have two replicas, two instances of our application. Then we can provide the container image in the version 1.0.0. We can open up a port. So let's maybe open up port 80 of this application. We could override the command that is executed inside of this image. So if you don't want to start the Apache running inside of here, we could start something else. We can set up environment variables if we want to. We can set up labels so that we can select and identify these pods later on. So maybe let's add a label app Symfony demo to it. We can configure health checks. For example, we can say, hey, Kubernetes only route traffic to this and mark these pods as ready if HTTP requests was successful on port 80 path slash. We can configure the network scheduling if we wanted to. We can also say, hey, please request maybe 100 milli CPU cores into our cluster, but limit it to one CPU core. We can also request and reserve 128 megabytes of memory and limit it to maybe 1 gigabyte of memory. We can, of course, change this all later on if we wanted to. And if we now click create, this UI will create a new deployment inside of our Kubernetes cluster. We can also check this with the CLI here. So you can see there is a Symfony demo deployment. We can also see that this deployment created two pods that are currently creating. And if we click on here on the on this deployment, we can see the same information here also in the UI. And while we have been talking, the first container is already running. Now the second container is running. And then I can also use this API to quickly start debugging this application. So I have this pod here. With one click, I can get an interactive shell directly inside of the running container. Should become available in a second. I can also, while this is waiting, have a look at the live logs going through here. Then start debugging stuff. Now, if we want to expose our application, these two pods here, to the outside so that we actually can see it from the browser, the first thing we have to do is create a service, an internal load balancer that gives us one single internal IP address in front of these two pods. So let's create a new service. We can also do this from the UI here. So we can say create a new service with an internal cluster IP. We can also give this a name. And then we can say, hey, we want to expose port 80 on this load balancer service that should direct traffic to port 80 on our pods, on our containers. And we can then say this service here, this internal load balancer, should direct traffic to all pods that have the label app with the value Symfony demo. And I should not make a typo. And if we create this now, we can see there is a new service. There is a selector here. We can also click on it, see an overview. And if we maybe have a look here quickly to see, we have our two pods with our two IP addresses. And we have our service here that also has an internal IP address that selects all pods with the selector app Symfony demo. And if we just say now describe service Symfony demo, we can also, I made here also a typo. We can see, okay, this is actually then directing traffic, a load balancer directs traffic directly to these IP addresses. And if we now start maybe editing our deployment here, and we say we want to have three replicas. It's going to start a third pod. And once this is started, we can also see this here inside of our list. While this is starting up, let's create the last missing piece. Let's create an ingress. So in this case, we also give this ingress a name, and we say that incoming traffic with this host name on all passes should go to the Symfony demo service on port 80. So if we create this, we have now created a routing rule. And if we now click on this link, we can see here is our Symfony application. And here are also the three pods behind this. Okay. If we have a look at the time, we are the 45 minutes are over. We have a couple minutes for questions. And while you can think about questions, and maybe we can answer already some of them, let's have a look at the last step that I want to show you, because this takes 2-3 minutes to deploy. Let's look at a bit of monitoring. And for that, we can go here to Apps and Marketplace, which gives us a lot of apps that we can directly include and install with a click. For example, a monitoring app. We just install it. And yeah, this will now deploy a completely pre-configured Prometheus Grafana monitoring stack with lots of alerts and dashboards. And yeah, maybe after a couple of questions, we can then start using this to have a look at the network I/O, CPU, and memory utilization of our application that we just deployed. And with that, first of all, I hope you got a good introduction at what Kubernetes can do and how quickly you can set something like this up and how easy that can be. And yeah, Scoop, do we have any questions already?
Yes, we do, Bastian. First of all, thank you very much for the information that you just shared, because it's very interesting. And even as a user of Rancher, I definitely learned a couple of things from this. One question that came in is how to handle local environment variables and production sensitive data.
Mm-hmm. Very good question. So usually, this is something you definitely should not put into side of your container image, like database passwords should not be into your container image. For two things. First, security. You're usually going to push your image somewhere to a registry. Either that could be an external one, like Docker Hub, or maybe something internal, like an internal GitLab or an internal Artifactory. But like, regardless of that, everyone who has access to this registry has access to everything inside of the image, so that could also be your database passwords. That is very likely not something you want. The second thing is then also, if you build one image, like this image 304, you want to be able to run this and test this in CI, on dev, and on production, and the database password is usually different between these environments. So one way to go about this in Kubernetes, you can put these, let's close this to make this bigger again. You can put this configuration, either you can just directly hard code this inside of a deployment. So you could, for example, say, hey, I'm adding here an environment variable, and I'm going to say db password test, that's possible. And I have an environment variable inside of this container. But then everyone who has access to this deployment and this cluster can just read this out. So probably a nicer way is to say, I'm going to put this into a secret, this information. So I can create a secret here for my Symfony app. And I can put key value, some information in here. And then I can, for example, limit the amount the users that can actually have a look at these secrets. So maybe not everyone is allowed to access secrets or create secrets or manage them, but all my devs should be able to create new deployments and manage them. And then when creating a deployment or adding one, I can, for example, say either I'm going to add an environment variable, and I add this environment variable from a resource and say I want to add an environment variable from my secret from the DB password field, and I get an environment variable DB password. Or I can say I'm going to create a persistent volume from the secret here. And then this volume I can mount into any kind of path inside of my application. And then inside of this container, I would have a folder app secrets. And inside of there, there would be a file called DB password with my content. And of course, this content I can put in here could also not only be a string, it could also be a complete JSON file, XML files, whatever I need as configuration.
So you could even put the .env file in there.
Yes. Yeah. And I oftentimes see this. And this is like the way to do this. And you can also iterate over this quickly because you can change the end file without having to build a completely new image. That's also quite nice.
Oh, that's nice. Then I get a question about centralized shared resources like PHP sessions, logs, or database connections. Is there a way to do that on a Kubernetes cluster?
In the end, you're starting processes on servers. So there is a way how to do everything. But there, of course, there is a bit of a but with it. Kubernetes has the nice property that you can quickly scale applications up or down. It distributes them on different nodes. And also, containers, by its nature, are usually stateless, and you put the state somewhere else. That means, for example, for session storage, you would probably create an additional Redis deployment here, and then point or a Memcache deployment, and then point your PHP application to use this external session storage. So it doesn't matter how many application pods you can scale up or down, it always goes to the same Redis cluster. And that way also you decouple the scaling a bit from that. That usually makes it a lot easier. For logs, there are also the logs are usually in container-based systems and in Kubernetes systems, you usually don't do anything about the logs directly inside of your application or your containers. You only directly put them to standard out. So when we have a look here at the logs, these are all the logs that my application prints to standard out. And then you put something inside of this cluster that takes the logs, the standard out logs from all of your applications and puts them somewhere else. So inside of Rancher, you could, for example, do this with a couple of clicks. You can install the logging app. And once this is installed, you can then say, hey, there is now this logging menu entry here. And you can say, okay, I want to create for all my logs an output. For example, I want to put all the logs into an Elasticsearch. And that is then running somewhere. This Elasticsearch could, of course, also run in Kubernetes. And then you can say, okay, all the logs from all my applications should go directly to this Elasticsearch cluster. So you decouple this from each other, same way you decouple the application and session storage, for example.
Right. On a related note, what about things like file uploads? Because that's going to be an issue if you have multiple containers spread out over multiple servers.
Yes, absolutely correct. For file uploads, you would create something called a persistent volume inside of your Kubernetes cluster. So if you go here back here to storage, you could say I'm creating a volume, but not from a secret, but for example from an NFS share or an AWS disk. Or so a lot of different volume storage providers. And for example, if you say we want to create a volume from an NFS share, yeah, we would put in the server here for where this NS share is present. Of course, this could also be, again, inside of your Kubernetes cluster, and then mount this, for example, to var uploads or wherever the file uploads is. And depending on the storage provider, for example, with NFS, we could just mount the same volume to multiple pods in all our instances, so that for uploads, we have one single volume there. That is one possibility.
Okay, that sounds good. I'm seeing no more questions. So, Bastian, I want to thank you very much for doing this talk, for answering the questions. Will you be in the chat later to answer any more questions?
Yep. I will be in the chat later, but let's quickly, since it's now installed, have a look at the monitoring, since it's there now. I was maybe a bit quick. So what I did is here, I went to the monitoring, and now we have here a completely pre-configured Prometheus Alert Manager Grafana stack. And of course, I can customize then at my own dashboards, at my own alerts to it, but it comes already with quite a lot of information of, first of all, how my cluster is doing. But then I also have dashboards to, for example, see how my single workloads are doing. So for example, I can say in the default namespace, my Symfony demo application, what are the different pods doing? How much CPU memory are they using? Also percentage-wise based on the requests and limits that I configured, but also absolute. I can have a look at the network bandwidth usage, and have then all the monitoring data I need to see where there may be a bottleneck. Yeah. And without starting completely from scratch with one click. And yeah, is there another question that came up in the meantime, or otherwise. I'll be definitely in the chat to answer them there.
No more questions. Thank you very much, Bastian.
Thank you.